There. Where's your patch, Jim? Or shall I say my patch that I loaned you?
He wants to make sure he sees you double. Maybe he'll get double price.
Yeah.
Double portion.
Hopefully the bullet will find the right one, huh? Is that what you're thinking? No. We're recording right now, aren't we? Okay, let's, we're going to begin our first class of The Heart of the Eternal Plan. And really, come on. I mean, this seems so much greater than the eternal plan of God, right? Yeah. But it's not the heart of the eternal plan we're after. It's the heart of God, you know?
Yeah.
So that's nice try, but anyway. So we can label this anything you want. But as long as you comprehend that we're going to be delving into things of the heart of the Lord from before the foundation of the world. And just in our little gathering we had Monday night, I had mentioned that there were two main aspects of the eternal plan of God as it relates to what was the will of God. And let me say this too. See, there's a whole lot of things to straighten out. When it talks about the will of God, we automatically think in terms of, you know, oh, what's the will of God for my life? Or what is it that I have to do? Or, you know, or find, you know, I have to find the will of God and all this kind of stuff. But particularly in the scriptures that we'll be looking at, and in my opinion, most of the meanings when it talks about the will of God, for example, in Ephesians, it's talking about that he wants, that he desires out of us. And so we talked a little bit about this. I introduced it. And the first aspect relates to, actually, I'll just do it this way since the way I'm going to present this. Okay. Last semester, we spent a whole quarter on the book of Revelation. And in there, we discovered that and you can see it from the beginning to end, that the Son had a desire, and that desire was for, I think it's a good idea to call it a counterpart. It is a mate. It is a what? Genesis says, one after his kind, let us make man in our own image after our likeness. It is not good for man to be alone, da 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 da. But by calling it a counterpart, you know, there's no male or female in that, and we understand that he wants someone that has his nature and is after his kind. And so, you know, I use the word wife more than I do bride nowadays, because the scriptures talk about it being the wife of the Lamb. So in the book of Revelation, chapter 2, and I'm just going to go over this a little bit before we go into the main thing that I'll be sharing this quarter. And that was, we saw and we've seen this. This is something that I've emphasized primarily for years, is this aspect. And it begins with the seven churches, and it begins with Jesus having to write letters to them, and they're not really love letters. You know, they're like, you know, you guys, you got this wrong, and you're doing this, and da da da. You know, when he does compliment them, it's like, you know, I'm really proud of you because you've been, you know, you hadn't left Christianity yet, you know. And they've been going through persecutions, and, you know, it's all there. It's been really, really hard because, you know, they thought Jesus was going to return immediately. They thought everything was going to be wonderful, and instead their own families, Jewish families, turned against them and all kind of stuff and all sorts of trials. And they were starting to lose heart. And John, who is also in prison, he's in exile on the Isle of Patmos, is also there, you know, as captives of the Roman Empire. And God catches him up out of that situation and begins to reveal God's plan. The first place he's caught up to is a multitude without number before the slain lamb on a throne. And they are worshiping the slain lamb. That's significant. They're not just worshiping God, and they're not just worshiping a lamb. They're worshiping the lamb that was slain, and that's what it says. Glory and honor, da-da-da, to the lamb that was slain, not to the lamb that was resurrected. And what is that identifying? That's identifying that they comprehend his nature, which is going beyond his hands and what he can do for you and all the blessings he can bring to you. And so then it moves to the middle part of the book of Revelation, where it describes the followers of the Lamb. And the number is not a number without number. It's 144,000. You can try to make significance out of that, but the biggest significance I see is that it's a lot less people than were around worshiping the Lamb. These guys are trying to follow the Lamb wherever soever he goeth. Okay? That's not easy because it requires that same nature, but it still puts them over here and Jesus here. And then the book of Revelation ends with chapter 21 and the angel saying to John, have you seen the bride, the wife of the Lamb? Okay, so this is big stuff because this is the culmination of what it's all about. Have you seen the wife of the Lamb? Do you understand what this has really been all about? Have you come to the culmination of this? And he goes, no. And so he takes him and he shows her. And of course, it's named New Jerusalem, but it's the wife of the Lamb. It's the city is us. It means it's more than two or three special people. And the most glorious thing specifically about her mentioned there is that her walls are of gold like transparent glass, where you can see inside of her, and what you see is the slain lamb, just like they saw in the fifth chapter when the book first started, on a throne, but he's enthroned in her now. The throne is not outside of them. The throne is within them. And that's beautiful. And from that, you know, is this flow of living waters, which Jesus told you. What is it, John 7 or something? He said, out of your innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. He told you, but you thought it was going to be because you were going to get filled with the Spirit, or that because you were going to really be able to talk a lot about Jesus, and, you know, you'd be a babbling brook and just keep, you know. But it's flowing out of the slain lamb on the throne. That's within her. So it is coming out of her. Out of her innermost being is an enthroned slain lamb. And then the scripture says that it's going out for the healing of the nations. And of course, by chapter 21, we're going, wait a minute, who's the nations, you know? Because we make it totally and strictly an end time book instead of a spiritual reality first. Spiritual reality first. And that this is true healing. It's flowing out of her. And so, anyway, so that's, you know, that we've discussed that aspect a lot. We've discussed it for years. But there is a second aspect here, and that is the Son wanted a counterpart, but the Father wanted sons. And I usually add to that sons in the image of Christ, or I say sons, what is my terminology I use there? Son of God by Christ, that you're son of God by Christ. And I do that with purpose and specifically based on certain facts that I've seen in the scripture that I believe are true. And we're not going to get into that right now tonight, but it has to do with adoption. And adoption is something completely different than American adoption or adoption as any other country does it. And it has within its elements an unveiling of how sonship comes about. And a lot of people, when they talk about God wanting sons, that was what was in his heart before the foundation of the world, they refer to it as sonship. And I did for years. And then the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, see, you always got to have the emphasis on you. He says, it's fatherhood. You know? He says, it's about the Father and what was in his heart. And yes, you're obviously a part of it and all this kind of stuff. But if you could imagine a man who wanted to have sons, and you see examples of this in the Bible, and what do you think that's reflecting? You know, wanting to have sons, and he starts having those sons, you know, like Jacob, like Israel, and the joy that he has over that. And of course, again, this is just like the bride is not gender specific, neither is being a son of God by Christ gender specific. It relates to the him being formed in us, and his nature being formed in us. So, you know, there's just this emphasis that we tend to lean toward, and it's one of the things that I'd like to maybe get across today, tonight, in either this first or second session, where I want to show that there is a very common way of viewing things that rob God and rob his heart because they don't include his heart. They don't even see it. They don't consider, that's maybe a better word, they don't consider his heart in that. Because so many things become religionized, and then our terminology forms up around it, and it all sounds good and it sounds right, to especially people who've been in the church for years and years and years. But I want to just show how it really does not honor, you know, in the case of if we were going to study the part of the son, and in this case doesn't honor the Father as Father, doesn't even sort of take that into consideration because it's being so religious. So you'd be praying for me in the course of the next few classes, because I really believe this needs to be seen, and there's no, in my heart, there's no anger or what's wrong with these people or, you know, this kind of stuff, because I did it too. There's only a true desire that the Father, just like we honor the Son, that the Father be honored with the same kind of heart, and that he be honored in the proper way instead of shuffling along through religious terminology that satisfies us but never satisfies him. So the first part of discussing this, the Father wanting sons, And it would be a good search for you to try to find out, and this isn't homework, you will, you know, if you don't do it, you'll go to hell. Just kidding, Skype people, we're just joking. and you don't want that. But it would be good for you to start into the scripture and say, Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit he's the best. He loves revealing the Son, and he'll reveal the Father and the Son. But Holy Spirit, open my eyes in the scriptures to this reality, this eternal plan in relationship to the Father wanting sons. And I mean, I remember when, you know, it sort of dawned on me that's a truth, but I didn't see the truth. I just recognized that I think that's a truth, because, you know, you can't go through John without running across the name Father 500 times a page or something, you know? I mean, it's just so big. It's so big. And I realized it was a truth, but I didn't see the truth. So I said, okay, I know how to search this out. So I got me a Strong's Concordance, which you don't necessarily need today. I have a Strong's Concordance on my iPad. But I got a Strong, you know, those big old Strong's Concordances. And I went through and I looked up every word, sons, you know, and I'm going to get this. And that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But the truth of it is so far beyond the terminology of the scriptures. And if it really is a father-son relationship that we enter into, which it is, it's going to take the Holy Spirit to reveal that. You're not, because it's between them. And we enter into that. So, as a matter of fact, I probably got, yeah. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And verse 9. God is faithful, by whom ye were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Okay, so that's our common grasp of fellowship. And it is a fellowship that is a fellowship that we have with Jesus. And the believer, and that little chart there is pretty much how we view it, that Jesus is above, and we have fellowship with Jesus, and the scripture sort of supports that. Now, if you would, turn with me to 1 John chapter 1. John 1, and we'll just start with verse 1. That which was from the beginning, so this beginning here, and you see that in the Gospels, you see John doesn't start at the same place the other writers do. You know, I think Mark starts with the coming of John the Baptist, the beginning of the Gospel. John the Baptist went out and preached. Matthew starts at the genealogy and takes it all the way back to Adam. But John, when he talks about the beginning, he's talking about before time. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. All things were made by him. in the beginning, see, that's the, there's this beginning before creation, and that beginning is in the heart of God and in the heart of his Son and in the heart of the Holy Spirit. And there are, see, that's why time and space can really mess with us, because we're just looking at things trying to figure out something that's eternal. You know, the spiritual realm, if we put it in that place, that terminology, spiritual realm, and then the temporal realm and the spiritual realm made the temporal realm, so that realm is more real than this realm. However, it's not just a spiritual realm. For us, it's this relationship of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit and how they relate one to another before time. And so that's going to require leaving this earth. And I'm not talking about the rapture. It's going to require going to, you know, there, and only the Holy Spirit can take you on those paths. So that which was from the beginning is where he's coming from. Before time, in the heart of God, which we have heard, which we have seen, and which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. So he's talking about Jesus, yes, but he's not talking about Jesus of Nazareth. Though they handled him, though they looked upon him, he has come to realize that this goes back before the beginning, that this is what we were with. This is what we were involved with, not just some guy that's the Messiah, or, you know, even the Savior of the world isn't enough. Because before God made a world, he wasn't a Savior. Except by nature. Amen. I'm glad some of you got that. Because by nature, that's what he does. He lays down his life. He gives. He pours out. He loses for others. All right. But he had no situation to manifest that. Can be real in you and never given an opportunity to manifest it. So, verse 2, for the life was manifested. There it is. The life was manifested. That's what he finally got hold of. The life. How many of you want the life? The life. And for the life was manifested, and we've seen it and bear witness and show unto you that eternal life. You see that? Eternal life is, as we always put it, without beginning and without end. Eternal. That's eternal life, is without beginning and without end, because it's eternal life, right? Eternal life is without beginning and without end. We enter into that life. You say, I've got eternal life, meaning, you know, now that I've received Jesus, you know, I will, you know, live forever. Well, so will people who haven't received Jesus. The only difference is where you're going to live it. But if you have this life, not just, oh, I met Jesus here, and now it goes forever. But if you have this life, and that's what John starts, and he's writing, and he's trying to communicate something that has changed his life. Because can you imagine walking with Jesus for 3.5 years in ministry, seeing all this wonderful stuff? I mean, he saw enough stuff that could keep him busy as this man's a prophet, this man's of God, this man is da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But not an ounce of that is going to reveal the one from the beginning. And that is eternal in being. Only the Holy Spirit's going to reveal that. So that's what it's going to take. That's what it's going to take. All right. So, now, was manifested, and we've seen it and bear witness unto you that eternal life which was with the Father. Is that big at all? It's huge. This is, what is it saying to us then? Well, it's taking Jesus and the Father outside of the realm of the earth, which is also taking him outside of the realm of sickness. Can I get an amen? And outside the realm of casting out demons. And outside the realm of everything that we've made important. And I'm not putting it down or saying it's not important, but I am saying this. Jesus himself is more important than anything he could have ever done or will ever do for you. He is. And to discover him is to enter into resources that are beyond just what he gives to temporal men in need. Think about it. Resources that are beyond just what he gives to temporal men in need and temporal needs. So, we saw the eternal life, which was with the Father, and it manifested. Okay, how do you manifest this life? Well, it's going to be manifested, and what we saw in the last semester was manifested in terms of a slain lamb. It was manifested in terms of Christ crucified. It's manifested in terms of this nature and this spirit, which is, you know, love, and God is love. See? And Jesus is not love. And the Holy Spirit is not love. And the Father is not love. But God, the three in one, there you will see the true meaning of love. So he says this thing was manifested. Well, now who's writing this? And what do you think is going to be huge in this epistle? Well, we know John wrote it because it's called First John. Thank you. yeah, you're with me. and what is going to be his main thing that he talks about? It's going to be the word love. Check it out. I mean, seriously, get in there. But it's not. We're not talking about sloppy agape. Meaning huggy, you know, that kind of thing. It is talking about the nature of love as seen in the Godhead. All right. So then he goes on to say, that which we have seen, this is verse 3, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you. Why are you doing that? That you also may have fellowship with us. Yes, okay. So here we go. Instead of it being pictured as this, where we only are believers having fellowship with Jesus, he's giving us an expanded view. It doesn't mean that was wrong. It's an expanded view of what's going on. So he says, we're having fellowship. Two believers, we're having fellowship. And that's why we're sharing with you, that we might have fellowship. But then he describes the true source and reality. But truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son and the fellowship that they have. We're entering into something eternal. Okay. If we fellowship with one another, many times our fellowship can be, not ours necessarily, but certainly, can be about what we're doing for Jesus, right? Or it can be about something Jesus did for us, right? But that's not this fellowship with the Father and the Son and the fellowship that they have, because Jesus doesn't go to the Father and go, you know, I got healed the other day, and you know, and woohoo, thank me. You know? it's not on the temporal basis. This fellowship was always there. And so just consider this. If we miss this relationship, then the Father's never going to get sons in the image of Christ. It's just not going to happen. You know? That we may be conformed to the image of His Son. So, John is writing to bring us into that. To bring us into that. And, you know, he realizes that he can't do that. But, you know, I'm a believer in seed, planting seeds. I believe that he can plant seeds in us from the Word of God, and that the Word of God is not just a study manual. Amen? You know, somebody says, well, this is my blueprint for life. You know, this is my study manual. This is my, it has to be more than that. It has to be the vehicle where seeds are planted in us, where we become awakened to things that we would never reach otherwise. Okay? And can't we all admit that there are areas in our life that we want to overcome, but can we also maybe believe that for some of those areas, maybe not all of them, but for some of those areas, the only answer is going to be seeing the Lord in some manner that we're transformed into that same image, not just Him doing something for us. Okay. And if we can agree with that, then we have to agree that we all have needs, and that we all, not one of us in this room or on Skype or wherever, not any of us have a handle on this enough to, you know, I mean, it is, I think it's fair to say none of us have a handle on it enough to even teach it. So I know what you're thinking. Then why the heck are you standing up here doing this? Because I believe in seeds. Do I need to repeat what I just said? I believe there are seeds here, and I believe, it says, how shall they hear without a preacher? And I believe there are seeds that go into us from the Lord that it may be years before they come up. You know, some seeds can sprout pretty quick, and, you know, Jesus wasn't real excited about their quick growth anyway in the parable of the sower. But, you know, a redwood tree takes a long time. But, man, it's going to be around a long time. You know, what was it? I think I said this before, but they were talking about some redwood tree in your state, Washington, that was alive, was there when David lived, King David. You're just going, oh, my God, how is that even possible? Well, you know. What does this look like when I'm... Especially when it's turned like here and you can't see it. Look at the colors. Jack Daniels. Not that I would know. not that I'd know anything about that. I'm a Christian. Anyway. Yeah. All right, so the important thing usually when the person writes this on the board, it's this little corner here. I'm fighting a...
There's a lot of pointing the fingers going on.
Oh, I just said that you wouldn't say anything, but you only did.
Yeah, you don't know me yet, but it's like, and you know, the Lord is, you know, He's all in here, and you go, where is the Lord? I see His heart, but nothing eternal. There you go. All right. So what one of the most important parts of really understanding the Father-Son relationship is the Son. And the Son as seen in the heart of the Father. And, okay, try to picture this with me. For us, the Son, we all came through salvation and had to consider our sins. Is that right? We all came and, you know, in many ways were learned Christian things and we went to church and we were, you know, some of us were healed miraculously or all sorts of things like that. But the Father toward his Son has a completely different view than us. And it is not based on anything temporal. Completely if you can imagine a total clean slate of everything that we've ever learned or thought religiously, and we could just see Jesus as he is, as the Son, and how the Father views him. Because see, the Father's never been healed. The Father's never even been down on this earth. Not, you know, like that. And so his view of the Son, and as we're going to see here in just a few minutes, just going through a couple of scripture, is so incredibly high of his Son. And so let's just start with Matthew chapter 3. And this is all preliminary to the bunch of the things that I feel like we need to get into, but I feel like there's needs to be a scriptural basis for some of these things. We can start at verse 13. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to the Jordan unto John to be baptized by him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? So you have a somewhat of a recognition by John that this one is more than he is. And he says that flat out to everybody. You know, I'm not even worthy to unloose his latchet. I'm not, you know, all this. You know, he's before me and all these things. And so there's a deference given to Jesus right here at the baptism. But that deference is probably at this stage the only person who has even given Jesus any sort of a, you know, in that sense. But look how far short it falls of what the Father says here as we read on. And Jesus answering said unto him, permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented to him. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. I have heard a phraseology, and it's fine. I don't have a problem with it at all. In fact, I've used it before. An open heaven. Anybody ever heard that phrase, an open heaven? And it's they tend to use it with seeing Jesus with clarity and from a heavenly view, meaning an above view, not necessarily heaven, but a heavenly view. And that's good. But the heavens were opened, and the Father, we've gotten something from the Father here. We've heard, think about it. Okay, let's try this. Since you're not Jewish. Imagine this being told to a Jew back then. And they're going, what? There's only one God, you know. And the Spirit came like a dove, and the Father spoke, and all of this kind of stuff. It's like, I don't even know if I believe this. See, because that was huge with the Jews, was there's one God. And all of the heathen nations around them believed in many gods. So this appears to them as many gods. More than one God, you know. And so this is the first time they or anybody really has heard from the Father, and it wasn't just a voice that sounded like thunder. The heavens were open, the Spirit came down on Jesus, and the Father is speaking at the same time, and there is, you know, there's so many possibilities of what could have been said, like, this is my son, and he's come to save you from your sins. And this is the beginning of that. And I'm God, the Father, and I'm going to give you a long speech about it. You know? I mean, it could have gone for a long time. It could have been all kinds of things. You know, I am the creator, and there's, you know, two more of us, but we're three in one, but we're one. You know, could have been an explanation of the Trinity. I know this looks weird to you, Jews, but this is the case. We're the Trinity. You know, and study it up. You know, for example, Elohim, which is always plural, the name when it's used in the Bible. Let us make man. But he didn't go there. He didn't try to explain himself. He didn't try to explain God. He didn't try to explain salvation. He didn't try to explain religion. I mean, it's big stuff. He said, that's my son in whom I'm well pleased. Do you see the revealing going on from there? It's not just Jesus being revealed. I mean, you know, I realize that Jesus went in there. John's going, I shouldn't be doing this because you're greater than me. The dove's coming down on Jesus. The Father's voice is coming down on Jesus. And everybody's attention is on Jesus, and as it should be, except when it comes to the eternal plan of God in relationship to getting sons for the Father, someone needs to take a moment to turn and to look heavenward and to listen and say, that came out of his heart, and I need to understand that. I need to hear that. I need to... You know what I'm saying? I don't just mean with your ears. I mean, I need to hear that. There is something so big that is the only thing he's spoken all this time. And all he's explained to us is that his son is very special to him. Okay. Now, why is that important to us? You say, well, it's good that he loves his son. Every father should. Because we're going to be found in him. When this is over, we're going to be found in Son. We're going to be found in him. And all that he says of the Son is going to be included with us because we're in him. So it's important to recognize the heart of the Father toward his Son. Now, he's never going to change his focus. It'll always be his Son. But it was, and if you take the time to study it out in Ephesians, the first chapter, even within the first few, the first chapter. What you're going to find is all of the things that were released and that were there from the foundation of the world, where it talks about not Jesus wanting that or doing that, but the Father. But him doing it by or in his son. It's a big deal. All right. So, there's another place where this takes place, and that's over in Matthew 17. Slightly different scenario. This is the Transfiguration. Verse 1, after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into an high mountain privately, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine like the sun, and his raiment was as white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto him, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three booths, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah, and one is two, and one more is three. While he yet spoke, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face. Good response. And were much afraid. Wrong book. That's another book. Somebody's getting these. And Jesus came and touched them and said, Arise and be not afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man except Jesus only. So, you can relate this story, and again, I'm sure I have many times. You can relate this story simply from the viewpoint of the Son, and not really necessarily include the Father, other than, you know, he spoke up. But you have Jesus there, and Jesus is shining. He's being transfigured by verse 2. So he's already shining out there, you know, and obviously different. And yet Moses and Elijah appear. And, you know, in what is it, Mark, or it says that they discussed his crucifixion, basically. But when Moses appears and Elijah appears, now whatever outshining Jesus is doing, they're just clumping this together. In other words, maybe they're not seeing Jesus fully in that light. They're seeing him in light of them. And as shared before, you know, and then a cloud comes and God says, this is my Son, and you only see Jesus, and we go, wow, it's all about the Son. But it was the Father who overshadowed this thing with a cloud. It was the Father who intervened in this situation. It was the Father who has something in his heart. It was the Father who is concerned about our viewpoints and our religious ways and the things that we're always adding in, and we never see his heart in this situation. And, you know, and someone could say, well, this is bad. God overshadowed us, and only Jesus was seen, and where am I in this? You know, I mean, I remember asking that at some point. You know, well, because I see Jesus as everything, I'm going, where am I in this? You know, and the Holy Spirit said to me, you're in the best possible place, the most safest, the most beautiful place you could be. You're in that Son. But if you don't see that, then you go, this is not right. I mean, we got Moses, we got Elijah, we got Peter, you know, we got James and John, the sons of thunder. I mean, this is big stuff. But the Father comes swooping in, as it were, and says, I need to change this view right now. I want you to comprehend the Son so that you can comprehend this relationship that you're going to enter into. That truly your fellowship is with the Father and with his Son. Is not just, you know, all of us one big happy family. And, you know, obviously part of that is that we learn to identify in Christ or in the Son. And, you know, the terminology is used in Ephesians and other places in Christ or in him and da-da-da-da. But if you look closely at those scriptures, and we will see that it mentions the Father and the Son there and what we're destined for, even though it doesn't give explanation there, but it waits till Galatians chapter 4. The Father, so there's this, you know, it's like there's this intervention, not of God, but of the Father. And would that he could intervene in our lives.
Amen.
Would that he would begin to move clouds over our concepts. And even our positioning of Christ. Well, he's the one that glows. You know what I mean? I mean, we know. So he is special above Moses. And he is, because he glows, you know. And he's going, look, that's not the issue here. He was glowing when they were here, and you're still including everybody. So the Father just shuts it down. Well, he's not going to override your will. He gave you free will, didn't he? He gave you free will. He's not going to make you see this in that sense, you know. This was written for our admonition. He wants, and see, John was there. Remember the guy who said that which was from the beginning? John was there. Now, he didn't see it then, did he? And you say, well, I don't know that I see this. Am I that far behind? Don't worry. You know, God has a prison island that he's going to put you on. That's right. And there was much rejoicing. All right, so... he overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud said, this, the only one left. I'm really trying to help us leap over our religious ways of viewing this thing. He didn't say, this guy's going to be the Savior. He's, you know, all your sins, all the messed upness of the world, this guy's going to fix it all. He is the top fixer of all time. There's something eternal. There's an eternal plan.
Yes.
Not just a plan of salvation. There's an eternal plan. And, you know, we were talking about this at Turner Falls, where Paul said, I travail in birth until Christ be formed in you. And you know, it was mentioned, and it's true that, you know, one woman's pregnant over here now and one's not, and this one might can go into travail then and whatever. But that ultimately is not the truth of that scripture, and it doesn't say, you know, it addresses something that is, remember in Romans 11, I can't remember, I think it's 19 or somewhere along in there, where he says, but you were grafted contrary to nature. Contrary to nature, there's something going on in that scripture too, and that is Paul said, the seed has to be formed in you, but I'm the one doing the travail. And Paul, you know, you look at Paul and you go, why is he always so, you know, why is he so, you know, passionate and all this stuff? Because he believes that he'll bear that travail so that Christ can be formed in there, contrary to nature. And that he is not just, see, he sees this. That's the problem, is we don't realize he sees the plan for the Son and what the Son really wanted and the Father and what the Father really wanted and why he flung creation into being and why all of this. He sees it, and it's all very clear to him. It's like, the Father wants this, and when we're in that realm and talking in that, and you see it in the scriptures, when you're talking there, it's about the Father getting sons in the image of Christ. And when it's the realm of the Son, it's about him getting a counterpart. But imagine this. Imagine it being so clear to him that everything's already been overshadowed. And he only sees issues in light of the heart of the Father or the Son. I mean, imagine that. And so he sees that the Galatians are going through stuff. Remember some of the stuff he said was, "Oh, foolish Galatians, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect in the flesh?" His reaction to that isn't, "I have taught you the Bible. Now you need to do it." You know what I mean? Or you know better. Or da da da. His response is Christ needs to be formed in you, and that's his word response. But his life response is, I take on the burden. Don't you worry about it. I will travail for you until Christ is formed in you. And so that doesn't come every once in a while. You know what I mean? Like a woman that has a child, okay, I'm in travail now, it's over with. A believer is, I'm in travail. No, he didn't say you're going through travail. He said, I do. I bear the burden for this. I planted the seeds. I feel responsible. And on what level? I feel responsible because I'm a Christian leader and I should. No, my God, no. He says, I see the heart of the Father that wants sons. I see the heart of Jesus that wants one after his kind. I see this thing, and I see straying. I see stuff going off, and I travail for that, and I'm not going to quit until Christ is born. You know what I mean? And it's not a religious thing. It has nothing to do with religion. It has nothing to do with, well, he's a passionate preacher. No, what it is Paul was passionate for the heart of God. He was passionate for the heart of God. He cared. He cared for him. Doesn't that sound strange? He cared for the Father. He cared for the Son. He cared that they get what they wanted before the foundation of the world. And so when he sees an incident or something, he doesn't, see, he's not looking around going, well, you're wrong. That's wrong doctrine. He could care less about your doctrine. Where's your heart? And so that's why I say it's clear. It's almost like, we talked about an open heaven. That heaven opens and he sees the heart of the Father toward his Son, and that he wants sons in the image of Christ, and it's a straight shot for him, and he sets to work to bring that about. He lives according to that. He sees, and there's nothing else that he's doing. I don't know how to explain this. There's nothing else that he's doing. He's just trying to bring about, we can say the eternal plan of God. That doesn't get it, does it? Or the heart of the eternal plan. That doesn't get it. The heart of God, the heart of the Father for what he wants, whether we understand that or now or not. Can we start with saying, Holy Spirit, start opening my heavens to the heart of the Father so that I can, if you're going to travail, you're going to travail for someone else to bring forth Christ. See, yeah. Because we're always so concerned about ourselves and everything, and it's always so self-focused. But, we have needs, and I understand. I'm a pastor. I'm here for you, and that's the truth. That's why he made me a pastor. But there's a part of me that's not a pastor. There's a part of me that's a son of God that wants that wants Christ formed in me and in us. You know? And there's a part of me that is wife of the Lamb, if you will. And how, if that is true in me, how can I not want what he wants in terms of those things? How can I not want that? What would be incredibly wrong with me to not want that with my full fiber if I'm truly wife of the Lamb? Do you understand what I'm saying? So this just all of this just wipes out. Can you imagine how much this cloud overshadows? You know what I mean? It just does. Now, and we need to quit so we can start again here in a minute. But there is this process that God has to work us through, from being a child to a son, and those are two different Greek words, and we're not going to deal with that tonight. But there is a process, and this child is not necessarily a baby, or not necessarily an infant, or childish. They are unaware of certain things that a son is aware of. And so yeah, there's needs and stuff. The Father's going to work you through that. So don't let me discourage you, you know. That's part of the process. But we have to realize where the process is leading. All right, let's...